Buenos días. Can you hear me? All right. How are you doing this morning? Okay. I will teach you the answer in Spanish. It's bendecido. How are you doing? Bendecido. It means blessed. Okay. So how are you doing?
Bendecido.
All right. So we are making progress on our Spanish lesson. So thank you for coming this morning. I'm a little bit nervous about today. This is my first confirmation class. So I'm praying, I'm asking that there'll be an example from now on. So I'm really pleased to work with these kids. And I know they are really well to commit their lives to Christ and to join the church this morning. So we are happy to have them here, and we are really glad for you to be here with them. Do we have any joys or concerns before we start?
Yes, I have a joy.
Okay.
This guy is 88 pounds today.
All right. Can we sing happy birthday or?
Happy birthday
to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Larry. Happy birthday to you. My wife would do the same thing. It's like, stand up. All right. What if we just got a couple minutes to welcome everyone and just get ready to start, all right? Please.
Of hope and light, in the midst of darkness, you offered light to the people who lived in fear. Today, the light comes to us as we celebrate the baptism of the Lord. Open our hearts this day and remind us that you have marked us as people of hope and light. Prepare us to serve you by serving your word. Amen.
Can we stand and sing the first song? Blessed Assurance, 369, all on the screens.
Mm-hmm. act as God's beloved ones.
What have we done to deserve God's love?
God's love is God's free gift to us, always and forever.
Even when we are difficult and turn away from God.
God's love never vanishes from us.
Thanks be to God, who is ever faithful to us.
Amen. Please be seated. Now is the time for the children's time. Children, come forward, please.
Google Maps?
Yeah.
Are they always right?
No.
We went to work in North Platte one time. Didn't know exactly where we were going. Got on Google Maps. It took us across cattle guards. It took us all over stuff. When we had the snowstorm here a few years ago, people were taken off of I-80 in Nebraska. Google Maps told them to come this way. That's why everybody was stranded. They were stranded out in the country. They were stranded. So these things like this aren't always what they're cracked up to be. Have any of you ever been lost? Have you guys ever been lost? A little bit? Were you a little scared? When I got out of school, I went to Kansas City and lived in Kansas City with my cousins. And one time some friends and I decided we were going to go for a walk. And we knew where we were going. Oh, no, we didn't. We got into some really crazy areas down there. And that time, yes, it's been a long time ago, we didn't have cell phones. We couldn't call anybody. We didn't know what to do, and we were pretty scared. Finally, I saw a street sign that said Oak, and that's where my cousins lived, so I knew kind of where we were at. But nowadays, the world's a little scary, isn't it? There's lots and lots of things going on, lots and lots of things that we don't understand. So what do we do? Do we have a map to guide us? About this one. This map will never change. This map will always tell us the way to go. When we are scared, when we're lonely, when we don't know what direction to go, all we have to do is look in this map. This map is consistent. This map is always there for us. This map will never, ever change. All we have to do is open it up and ask God for direction. So no matter what situation we're in, if it's at school, if it's at home, no matter, this map is always there. I can almost guarantee you that looking at this map, there's some roads that are closed. This is 2012, and you know how long we had to dig to find this? A long time. I sent my son a message. I said, do you have a map or an atlas? He said, I have an iPhone. You're going to have temptations. You're going to have people wanting you to go a different direction. Always depend on this map.
Amen.
Okay, you guys join me in a prayer? Dear Jesus.
Dear Jesus.
Thank you for loving us.
Thank you for loving us.
For guiding us.
For guiding us.
And always being with us.
Help us to always remember
to follow the map that you have given us.
To follow the map that you have given us.
In Jesus' name we pray.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
You don't want any? Go for it. You got some? I'm down. Bruce smiles, so it's my eyes. Can you smile?
Oh, hey, you should be. Have you seen these kids' faces when you, when I on Lee given the treat? They look like a, well. Inside they're smiling, but they're like a, well, if you give it to me. I'm really excited this morning, and also I'm really thrilled to see Lucille here. Welcome, Lucille. Really happy to have you here this morning. Every Wednesday and we see each other, sometimes I ask him about how she's doing, and he says, well, being about 102, I'm fine. So. All right, brothers and sisters in Christ, this is a really special Sunday for the church, but also for these beautiful girls and not so beautiful boys. But through the sacrament of baptism, we are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation. We are initiated into Christ's holy church. And we are given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift, sorry, offered to us without price. Through confirmation and through the reaffirmation of our faith, we renew the covenant, declare at our baptism, acknowledge what God is doing for us, and affirm our commitment to Christ's holy church. This morning, we are going to have some baptism confirmation and a new member's reception. So I will call McKenna, yes, Brass, to be at front, and her parents, and witness. You have any witness with you? McKenna, right here. Right here. Yeah, come forward, please. Behind her. Thank you. Can you face me, please? Well, now, for now, just face the church. Dear brothers in Christ, I present to you McKenna Brass as a candidate for the baptism this morning. Now, can you just face to me now, please? We ask you, Lord, that with your Holy Spirit, you bless this water that is going to be poured out on McKenna's head as a testimony of her decision to follow your steps, to be your disciple, and to abide and obey by your word. Help her to fulfill her promises. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Kneel, please. The Holy Spirit work within you, and being born through water and Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. McKenna, child of God, you have you are sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism and marked as a Christ on forever. I baptize you in the name of Jesus Christ, in the name of the Holy, in the name of the Son, the Father, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Can you lay your hands on her? McKenna, through baptism, you are incorporated by the Holy Spirit into God's new creation and made to share in Christ's royal priesthood. We are all one in Christ. With joy and thanksgiving, we welcome you as a member of the family of Christ. Amen. Can you stand, please? Would you join to face? So once more, now, the newborn baby in Christ, McKenna, is being introduced to you. God bless you all. Thank you.
God, when there was only chaos, you divided the dark waters and brought light. In the days of Noah, you saved those in the ark through water. After the flood, you put a rainbow in the clouds. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom across the sea. You brought his children across the Jordan to the land you promised. Sing to the Lord all the earth. And tell of God's mercy each day. Then you sent Jesus, who was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit, and then you called his disciples to participate in the baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all nations. Wash away their sin and clothe them with righteousness throughout their lives, so that dying and rising with Christ, they can participate in his final victory.
All praise,
all praise to you,
eternal Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ,
who lives with you and the Holy Spirit,
lives and reigns forever. Amen.
Now, would you answer the questions that are going to be asked? Yeah. This is the whole church.
If you'll stand. Let us join in professing the Christian faith as contained in the scriptures of the Old and the New Testament. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father, and creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and is buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. Seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Since the earliest times, the vows of Christian baptism have consist, first, of the renunciation of all that is evil, and then the profession of faith
and loyalty to Christ. The whole church reaffirms these vows for themselves while taking up these responsibilities for the conference. Please be seated, and I will call the kids. The whole kids come over here, please, with me. Right here. Make a line and face me, please. Thank you. I know that you don't like me, but you have to face me this time. So, Alexis, McKenna, Sammy Joan, Carter, Mason, Bella. Who are you? Oh, Matt. We have been working through the whole this time, couple months, getting some knowledge about God's word, about our commitment with the church. So today is the day. Today is the day when you, if you want to, you will commit your life to Christ and to the church membership. Our last session, we have a really serious conversation about this matter. And I want to repeat it again. It was your parents' decision to be baptized when you were little ones, not you, but everyone else. It was your parents' decision to take you into the Holy Church teaching. But now, it is your personal decision to make. You have grown enough to make that decision. So I will ask you, would you like to become Christ's followers and church members? All right. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you reject the spiritual forces of wickedness? Reject the evil powers of this world and repent of your sins? Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord? According to the grace given to you, will you remain faithful members of Christ's Holy Church and serve as Christ's representatives in the world? Will you? Oh. I will call, please, to stand up the parents and the sponsors. Do they have it, please? Will you stand? And this is a question for you. Will you, who sponsor these candidates, support and encourage them in their Christian life? Do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both rejection and sin of your commitment and your commitment to Christ? Are you afraid to say, I do, you do? You should. All right. Please kneel. Thank you. Be seated. With God's help, we commend your life under the influence, the guidance, and the advice of the Holy Spirit into Jesus Christ. Amen. Would you stand, please, and read? With God's help, will you nurture one another in the Christian faith, in life, and include these persons now before you in your care? The whole church. Surround these persons with a community of love and forgiveness,
that they may grow in their trust in God.
and be found faithful in their service to others. We will pray for them. So, I advise you to fulfill this promise. I asked you before, are you concerned? Are you afraid? You should, because we are committing also, renewing our commitment to live in front of these kids by example. So, these kids has been confirmed and reaffirmed their faith and water. I will ask you to just get a little water, put it in your front head, your forehead. You also. It is important for all of us to have stepping stones in our way, in our journey to Christ. That way, when trials come, doubts assault our mind and our faith, we have a firm foundation. So I'm encouraging you to think and remember this day and forever. When you become an adult, when you become parents, you have to have this in mind. Whatever happened in your life is on God's control. You have to trust Him, you have to believe, and you have to obey. And some way or another, everything will be okay. The Holy Spirit works within you, that having born of the water and the Spirit, you will be able to live as a faithful disciple of Christ. Remember your baptism always and be grateful.
As members of Christ Universal Church, will you be loyal to Christ through the Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries?
Okay. Go ahead.
As members of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, and your service, as well as your witness?
Now, I want to call Mr. Mike Bundle to be received also as member of, he's looking for membership in our church. He is transferring his membership from somewhere else or just be. Mike, I want to ask you, as a member of Christ Universal Church, will you be loyal to Christ, to the United Methodist Church, and do all in your power to strengthen its ministry? As member of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministry by your prayers, your presence, your gift, your service, and your witness?
I will.
Can you now face the whole church, please? Members of the household of God, I commend these persons to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love. Will you please read? We give thanks
for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love as members together with you in the body of Christ and in the congregation of the United Methodist Church. We renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church.
Now, can you face me, please? I welcome you as a member of the St. Francis United Methodist Church. I welcome you as a member of St. Francis United Methodist Church. Mason, I welcome you as a member of the St. Francis United Methodist Church. Sammy Joe, I welcome you as a member of the St. Francis United Methodist Church. Carter, I welcome you as a member of the United Methodist Church. Alexis, I welcome you as a member of the United Methodist Church. Mike, I welcome you as a member of the United Methodist Church. Bella, I welcome you as a member of the United Methodist Church. All right? So, the God of all grace, who has called us to eternal glory in Christ, establish you and strengthen you, that you may live in grace and peace. God bless you all. Can you just face the church? Can we just give him a clap, please? All right, please, be seated. Let's continue with our program.
Your law. I meditate on it all day long. Your commands are always with me and make me wiser than my enemies. I have more insight than all my teachers, for I meditate on your statutes. I have more understanding than the elders, for I obey your precepts. I have kept my feet from every evil path so that I might obey your word. I have not departed from your laws, for you yourself have taught me. How sweet are your words to my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth. I gain understanding from your precepts, therefore I hate every wrong path.
Our second reading is from New Testament 1 John chapter 2, verses 3 through 11. It's a responsive reading, so can you please stand? We know that we have come to know him if we keep his commands. But if anyone obeys his word, love for God is truly made complete in them. This is how we know we are in him.
Whoever claims to live in him must live as Jesus did.
Dear friends, I am not writing you a new command, but an old one, which you have had since the beginning.
This old command is the message you have heard.
Yet I am writing you a new command. Its truth is in him and in you. Anyone who claims to be in the light but hates a brother or sister is still in the darkness.
Anyone who loves their brother or sister exists in the light, and there is nothing in them to make them stumble.
But anyone who hates a brother or sister is in the darkness and walks around in the darkness. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated.
May you please stand and worship with us, singing "Standing on the Promises."
Standing on the promises.
time. Thank you. Please be seated. I'm really amazed and I'm really thrilled about this group. But I have to say, these girls are outstanding. And no doubt how the girls will rule this world anytime soon. So I want to talk to you about how we can show the world God is in us. The first letter of John talks about three things that identify us as Christians. John says, he lives in the light. It means everything he does or she does is truth. And everybody can see it. Faces failures. It means that we are aware that we are sinners and our failures happen every day, all the time. But we strive not to sin. Even though we fail, our goal is not to sin. And that is the three characteristics that identify us as Christians. He tells us that if we practice living as Jesus lived and loving as Jesus loved, then everything is going to be okay in our relationships, in our home, in our school, in our jobs, wherever we go. Well, it sounds easy, isn't it? Just be like Christ? Yeah, right. Do everything Christ did? Yes. Live as he lived, it sounds just kind of easy peasy, right? But that's the big enchilada. You know what? It takes really a challenge. It takes a lot to be like Christ. So the message this morning is, we show that we know God when we do what he says. And John was really serious about this. And he reinforced the importance of our Christian testimony, and he continually calls us to lead by example. Okay? Most people say, do what I say, know what I do. Well, that's not the case for the Christians. We must say, follow my example. For instance, the word know, it happens 40 times in this small letter. 40 times John says to the church, know. Know God, know Christ, know this, and know the church. So, John is not talking about intellectual knowledge, okay? John is not saying that you have just learned the Bible by heart. That's the important part, but it's just halfway. What John is trying to encourage the church is know Christ by your experience. So it means that through the Bible, through our prayers, through our Christian commitment, we are able to experience Christ in our lives. That has to be the goal. To know by experience how Christ works. How God's blessings, how Christ is calling us to follow his example. So let's just start for the live as Jesus lived. There is a big difference between knowing about God and knowing God. And we were talking about knowing about God is what we heard in the church, is what the Sunday school classes teachers told us. It is what the pastor preaches every Sunday. But knowing God is something personal. When we heard the word of God, when we read the word of God, and we obey his word, then the love of God is perfected in us. Experiencing God's word is living by him
as he lived is when we read something in the Bible, we just practice it. One thing we can all relate to. Love your parents. Obey your parents. Not just read it in the Bible, not just hear it in the Sunday school class. You have to practice it. Huh? Can I ask your parents if you obeyed them? You will pass the test. What about love your brother and your sister? One thing is to stand my brother and my sister sometimes, right? And we fight almost every day for anything, right? Yeah, I know that, yeah. And I know by experience that that happened. So, if we live and we imitate Christ, then we should stand, we should endure, we should support, we should love our brothers and sisters. The test of whether we know God has more to do with our behavior rather than our beliefs. Jesus said it in John chapter 14, 21. He who has my commandments and keeps them is who follows me, loves me. I mean, it is not just reading the Bible. It is not just hearing the preaching every Sunday. It is not just about going home and watch sometimes TV preachers and heard about the Word of God. It is about obey God's Word. Every step in our lives have to be according to Christ. So, to say that we know God without recognizing His authority in our lives is an empty claim. God fulfills His purpose in us. The reason God gave us His love is not just to make us feel good or heal our wounds. His final purpose is to lead us to obedience. Some people, they follow Christ because they feel okay. They feel like, okay, this is something I never experienced before. And I want to feel myself okay. But feeling okay, not all the times is okay. We can feel okay practicing things that we know are not approved by God. And people don't care about that. So feeling okay is not always the right thing. I think, as I age, because believe it or not, I was once your age. Do you remember that beautiful time when we didn't feel any pain in our body, when we just enjoy ourselves jumping and riding horses and riding a bike and do whatever, no consequences? Yeah, we thought that we were plastic boys and girls, right? But then the time shows us, proves that we were wrong, right? Now we feel the consequences of those acts. Well, seems like the church is just not understanding what God is trying to tell us. Think about the time when we were this age. I remember that every Sunday I was ordered by my mom to wear my best clothes. Do you remember that? Sunday was to dress nice and well, right? Some families has a tradition to have a new cloth on Easter Sunday, right? So the parents bought dress for the girls, pants for the boys, something nice to dress on Easter Sunday, right? So we were somehow ashamed of show some holes in our clothes. Do you remember that time? It was about my middle school time when I was ashamed to show any holes on my pants. So somebody got the good idea to put some patches. You just have ironed those patches over the hole, and voila, right? Now, people is not ashamed to not to wear those holes. The whole pant is a hole. Have you seen them? And not just that, they're expensive pants. I had been a city boy all my life. And wearing jeans, when someone was wearing jeans, it was because he has not enough money to buy some dressing clothes. I'm speaking about cities, okay? I'm not speaking about rural towns. So when you wore jeans, it's like, your parents were really financial troubles. Now, jeans are the expensives, right? So, seems like things change in the world. Time change, tradition change, but the church abides for the same rules. Christ example. And that will never change. God's commandments we have to follow, and that will never, never change. But let me tell you, George Barna, in his book, Future Cast, recorded changes in American Christians' behavior from 1991 to 2011. And he shows that traditional religious beliefs and behaviors are on declining, except for two of them. More people say that they have accepted Jesus as their Savior and hope to go to heaven. That's one. And the second is that many more say they have not attended church in the last 6 months except on special occasions. So this is the paradox. We say that we believe in Christ, but we do not go to the church for long periods. We want to be saved, but we do not want to follow the Savior. We want to go to heaven, but we are not following the rules. And that's dangerous, my friends. We cannot go to somewhere knowing where it is. It just, when Pat was teaching the sermon to the kids, it brought me a flashback to when we got here. The first weeks we were here, some of you advised me, have you been someplace? Have you been some there? No. Well, Julie advises us, go to the 3 points where Nebraska, Colorado, and Kansas join. It's a nice kind of a view. So we were exploring the surroundings, and I took my wife and said, let's go all the way to Ray. And we just drove, and we have a meal Hagler. So in Hagler we stopped and we had a breakfast there. Then we moved to Ray and then drove back. And our way back, my wife says, let's go to the 3 points. Why not? So we set the GPS, and they took us out of the highway for a dirty road. We drove about 20 minutes, maybe. It was a day after rain, so there were some muddy places. My pickup was just washed a day before. So we went, and it was kind of a really little scary and some of those muddy places. So at some point I was feeling, where are we going? I mean, we were feeling lost. So there was a camp for those folks who worked making gravel and material for the highways. So I stopped and asked them. And my wife immediately thought about those pictures when you ask an exchanger and something, and then just pull a gun on you and say, you are I said, no, don't ask, don't stop. I have to, we are lost. Well, not always relay in what people tells you, okay? So a young man came to me and I said, you know what, it seems like we are lost. We want to go to the 3 points, wherever Kansas, Nebraska, and Colorado join. And then he says, well, just follow the road. So it seems like we went in the right direction. 15 minutes after, the GPS says, you have arrived in the middle of nowhere. The GPS got lost, and we also. So do not rely on what people says all the time, okay? The best way to live is when we have doubts, when we have problems, when we are facing challenges, go to the Bible and ask, what is God telling us? What I should do in this case? What I should do with this problem? So, in our way back, I said to my wife, well, what if we take a different road? And then she says, no, stay to the road. So we drove back for the same road. Until today, we have not seen the 3 points place. But it's in my plans this summer. It's in my plans. So, George Barna, in his book, Future Cast, he reported also that people say, I believe in God. I think the Bible is a good book. And then I believe whatever I want. Is not that some kind of a not matching thing? I believe in God. I believe the Bible is a good book. But I do what I want. So, this morning we, through the promises, we recommit ourselves. We have to redirect our way in the right way. On the first time when we came here in 2005, that we came on winter. So that summer we went back to Mexico. And that time there was no GPS and no iPhones. So my wife, the AAA gave us the Atlas at that time. Somebody says, because I hired the AAA services, and they gave me a sticker. I was talking to a friend, and it says, do never put your sticker on your window. This sticker, AAA stickers, in your window. And I say, why? Well, because this is telling the people you do not know how to drive. So do not wear that. So I never put it in my window. But my wife has an Atlas, and it was the first time we drove back to Mexico. We took the highway 35 and then 54, and then we ended up in a place called Tucumcari. Believe me, that is a place where you do not want to spend the night. It's nothing else. I mean, it's just a gas station, barely. So I just start driving, we pass by, and sooner than later, we got lost. I got into dirty road, gravel road, going somewhere, and always my GPS wife start just like, we are lost. No, we are not. Yes, we are lost. No, we are not. So she finally, I have finally to admit I was lost. So we stopped, and then she was reading these maps, and she took us out to our way to Alamo Gordo and then El Paso, and then if we do not follow what is written, if we just guess what is ahead and what will be the best way to go, probably we can find ourselves in the midst of problems. That is God's words, wisdom that we have to learn by experience, not just by knowledge, mentally knowledge, intellectual knowledge, by experience. We have to do what the Word of God says
and we're going to be in a safe place. Well, Barna says that in 1991, 24% of America's population were not believers. Today is at 37%. We are designer society. We want everything customized to our personal needs, our clothing, our food, our education, and now it's our religion. We do not really think about what cares for, what God cares for. We think about what I care for. We do not think about what God wants from me. Now we care about what I want from God. How well committed is our life to Him? Are we working towards heaven? Are we doing the right thing? Are we following Christ's follow example? Well, that's the talk. That's living as Christ lived. Let's just talk about the walk. Walking implies forward movement, healing towards a goal. It doesn't say it's leap or sit. It doesn't say just jump high, fly, or run fast. Walking involves taking firm and safe steps. John says, we know that we are in Christ because we walk like Him. Now, this is a question for everyone. Do you walk every day? I'm not saying just walking to the store, walking to the school, walking to your job. Do you exercise? Do you walk every day? You know, we like to drive, isn't it? The grocery store is just 2 blocks away from my home. At the very beginning, I just took my car. My wife says, go and bring some meal, bread. And then I went to the, because I have to obey my wife, you know. So I drove there. Yesterday, I found Travis at the lumberyard. My son needs a drawer, and my wife found some for him, and she asked, do you like this? And he says, well, yeah, but I prefer it to be black. You know what that means? Somebody have to paint it, so I have to paint it. So I was in the lumberyard and I trying to find, I also have a bookshelf that I need to restore. Just scrub, dig the debris out of it and just paint it. But you know how hard it is for me now go to the basement and get out the tools. Just thinking in the whole process, it takes me an hour, maybe. Let's talk about the walk. Well, I find out I have to go to the lumberyard to find some sandpaper and some nails and some things that I will need. I find out that in the lumberyard it will be really a lot of things I do not need. I just need maybe 1 or 2 sandpapers and maybe just a few nails and maybe things like that, but I have to buy a bunch of them. So thanks God, Travis was there and he said to me, what are you looking at? I explained to him, I said, well, let's go to my shop. And he gave me some stuff that I was really grateful for. So the thing is, if we do not have help, we were out of motivation anytime soon. That's why we need church. That's why we need to each other, to encourage each other, to support each other. That is the promise that you make on these kids. You will support them with your prayers, but also you will lead them with your example. And living by example is not always easy. Walking is not always easy because we are used to
drive. We like our pickups, we like our cars, the AC in summertime, the heater in wintertime, right? Yeah. It's not a bad thing. But the problem is we are losing our ability to walk. How is your walking lately? How far you have come? Does everyone see you walking like Jesus walked? We must walk as he walked. So just do it. Do you remember the phrase, "What would Jesus do?" It was a campaign from years ago. That phrase, "What would Jesus do?" has been used as a guide of behavior to a standard Christian living. Asking the question and its implication can positively impact all areas in your life. The origin of this phrase, "What would Jesus do?" arose from the biblical concept of imitation of Christ. In 1890, Reverend Charles Sheldon was leading the Central Congregational Church in Topeka, Kansas. He was frustrated by the lack of attendance on Sunday services and decided to try a new approach to his messages. So the pastor recognized the challenges of imitating Christ while living a modern life. So he came up with the idea to composing a series of what he called sermon stories to address the problems in Sunday services. Each week, he would host an episode that described a moral dilemma someone might face. All these messages ended up with a cliffhanger and the questions, "What would Jesus do?" In his book, Pastor Charles Sheldon, based on 1 Peter 2:21, says, "Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow his steps." The book's main character is a pastor who challenged his congregation to do nothing for an entire year without asking the questions, "What would Jesus do?" The author talks that all the characters, their lives were changed. Think about ourselves. Our life would change if we just, before taking any decisions, we give them a thought about what would Jesus do? What would Jesus want? The Christian life comes down to who you follow. So who do you follow? Are you following yourself? Are you following anyone else? Or are you following Jesus to live as he lived and love as he loved? How is your walking in Christ doing? Do you like him? Do you walk like him? People can see Christ in you. Would your reflections, your decisions, your choices will show that you are following Christ? Saying that we are Christians and living as Christians, there are two separate things. What are you doing? And more than that, what will you do? Will you join me, please, in the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power. Amen. This is the time for the offertory. We have heard your word, O God, and we know that it's a challenge. It's always difficult. But we are aware that your Holy Spirit is here with us, among us, to help us to follow your lead. Please help us to show Christ, to show God loves in everything we do every day. We present these offerings to you. Please receive it. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Please be seated. I will call these kids to go away with me when the acolytes come, the candelabras comes, and get the light. Just let's all follow him, okay? And we're going to be back there, and everybody, please, I will invite you to come and welcoming as part of the family of God. Can we do that? Are you awake? I have seen some people nodding, so it's a little hot today. Thank you for standing all this time. But it is the time to go, to do our normal life. It is the mission field we're going into. Follow Christ's lead. Every day, try to be like him. It is hard, yes, but we also have the promise that he will not leave us alone. He will give us the Holy Spirit help and strength to be like him. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God and the fellowship with the Holy Spirit be with us and today and forevermore. Amen.
Will you please stand and sing with us? It is as well as with my soul.